Okay, hello, welcome back to one of the most entertaining and educational games of chess that you will ever see. Why is that, I hear you ask? Well, today we are going through another of Emory Tate's chess masterpieces. But before we get into this piece of art over the board, I'll first give you guys a bit of context about the game. Unlike most of my previous Emory Tate videos, this game is actually relatively recent. This game was played on the 26th of January 2013 between Emory Tate with the white pieces and a man by the name of Artur Chibukhchian with the black pieces. It was played in the 2013 North American Open, a tournament in which there were around a dozen grandmasters and 500 other players. Chibukhchian, of course, was one of the grandmasters, around 150 ELO higher rated than Tate at the time. However, those of you who have watched my other Emory Tate breakdowns will know that he doesn't seem to care about his opponent's rating, crushing stronger players left, right, and center. This game contains some of the most ruthless, unforgiving, attacking chess tactics that I've ever seen. However, before we get into the game, I'm very excited to tell you that this is my first sponsored video. Let me paint you a picture. It's 2 a.m. and you've just finished playing 4 hours of chess to have ended up 20 ELO down from where you started. You have to be up at 8 o'clock and you're setting your alarm, wondering why you even played this stupid game that hasn't even had an update since the 17th century. No? Just me? Okay, well, anyway, if you want to get better at chess without emptying your wallet, be sure to check out Hercules Chess. They are an entirely free chess training tool who want to help you raise your game. They provide over 2 million unique puzzles alongside a puzzle rush feature that, unlike some websites, doesn't ask for your card details every time you use it. They also have a focused endgame tool allowing you to practice key checkmates with the different pieces and a growing variety of chess bots for you to conquer. Click the link in the description to sign up to Hercules Chess for free and make sure you use my link, so they'll sponsor me again. Okay, so let's get into the game. Tate opens with the move e4, of course. Chibukhchian responds with a Sicilian defense, c5, and then knight to f3 from Tate. Unlike the previous Emory Tate games we've looked at, in which his opponent has gone at d6, or even he has played d6 at times, playing these more modern Sicilians with a6 and ideas of the Nidorf, we see e6 here. Chibukhchian going for the French variation of the Sicilian. d4. cd4, knight d4, and Chibukhchian plays a6. This is known as the Khan variation of the Sicilian, immediately clamping down on any idea of knight b5, which Tate might want to play to exploit some of these weaker dark squares that have been weakened by that push of e6. Also, potential ideas of queenside expansion with the move b5 are quite common, fianchettoing this light squared bishop. It's a very, very standard move. Here, Tate plays the move knight to c3, playing the knight variation of the Khan variation of the Sicilian defense. Queen to e7 from Chibukhchian, immediately shutting down ideas of this e5 push. However, Tate says, no, I might want to play e5, and so plays the move f4, ready to justify the push of that pawn, as we'll see later. Chibukhchian responds knight to c6, and Tate plays bishop e3, further reinforcing that knight in the center and just stabilizing the position. We see a b5 now lashing out here on the queen side, as I said, this a6 move justifying that, and then Tate goes for queen to f3. This is a line that has only been played in 47 of the games in the master database on Lee Chess, but the queen's really well positioned here, exerting potential pressure all the way down this diagonal on the rook on a8, also on f7, which is quite a weak square. The king only protects it should the f file open, which is made a lot more probable by the fact that the move f4's occurred. So, you know, very, very dynamic. Can't really be punished because this bishop can't really get to g4 through these pawns. Very interesting move. So here, Chibukhchian does place his bishop on b7, you know, securing this diagonal a little bit from the queen, perhaps ready to take here, and after takes, there's going to be some quite nice pressure exerted on that e4 square. After bishop to d3 here, stabilizing that e4 square, and knight to f6, we see that queen f3 was actually quite a multifaceted move, leaving Tate here with the option to castle queenside or kingside, and of course, he goes for the more active, more aggressive option, castling queenside, bringing the rook to that open file, ready to maybe use these pawns to attack the black king. The bishop comes to e7 here, and Tate just takes a second, stepping across with king b1, almost always going to be a good idea if you castle queenside to try and play that move king b1, stabilizing the a2 pawn a little more and getting off of this dark square diagonal. Chibukhchian carries on expanding on the queenside with tempo with that move b4, kicking Tate's knight back to e2. Up until this point in the game, the position has been ultimately balanced with dynamic attacking play for both Chibukhchian and Tate. However, it is here that Chibukhchian goes slightly wrong and plays quite a dubious but quite an intuitive move, d5. Now, it is not at all clear why this move d5 should be considered suboptimal until Tate shows us why. This moment harks back to Tate playing f4 super early on move 6, as he pushes past this tension with the d5 pawn, playing the move e5. The knight is of course forced to move. Chibukhchian jumps forward into the e4 square here. And some of you might think, wait, is that not just a free pawn? I mean, bishop takes, pawn takes, queen takes. What's wrong with that? However, in this position, black could play the move knight takes d4, discovering this attack onto the queen, the bishop held by black's queen, taking the piece. The only move for Tate is going to, of course, be recapturing that knight with the queen. And then there's going to be bishop takes g2, winning back the pawn. And, you know, black's left with a bishop pair, a lovely position. You know, this rook's going to have to move straight away. It's not ideal. Probably there's going to be ideas of rook to d8 coming to the d-file with tempo on the queen. This wouldn't have been a good option for Tate. So instead of erroneously trying to take a free pawn, Tate plays the best engine move, of course, knight to g3. After Chibukhchian steps back with the knight to c5, I mean, it seems like a very, very normal position. It seems like there's a lot of tension here. All the minor pieces are developed. Yes, there's a bit of a space advantage here, but maybe after castles and then the rooks can come to the open c-file, for instance. There's a lot of pressure. It's a dynamic game. However, in this position, Tate makes some very specific exchanges. First, he takes the knight on c6, and after the bishop recaptures, he then takes the knight on c5, rendering Chibukhchian entirely knightless after bishop takes bishop. Now, it's not immediately obvious why Tate has chosen to give up the bishop pair in quite an open position until we see his next move, f5, trying to break open these pawns and get the black king, who is still chilling in the center on move 17. He wants to blow this all open, bring the rook to the f-file, and try and checkmate that black king nice and early, using his knight. Maybe he even goes via h5, puts pressure on g7. If he can break open this position while Chibukhchian's king is still in the center, it's going to be good for Tate. Now, a lot of you are probably thinking, why did he need to make these two trades in order to play this move f5? Well, hopefully that'll become clear when I show you what happens if he didn't make either of those trades. If he tried to play f5 before either of the trades, we would have seen knight takes e5. The queen would have to move. He would have lost a pawn. This would not have been good. Now, to some of you, maybe this trade makes sense. Knight and then bishop recaptures. I mean, fine. But now why doesn't he play f5? Well, in this position, there is d4, discovering onto the queen while attacking the dark squared bishop. And we see that trading off this dark squared bishop for the knight isn't as much about removing the knight from the board as it is removing the dark squared bishop from this inopportune square, such that d4 discovers onto the queen and itself at the same time. Back to the position in the game, and it's time for Chibukhchian to deal with this aggressive pawn break in the center that Tate has made. Unfortunately for Chibukhchian, he goes about this in a way that Stockfish is not best pleased with. He simply castles, which seems reasonable, because if takes, there's going to be takes here, the rook will open onto the queen. Why not? Well, funnily enough, in this position, there is the move knight to h5, which just exploits the weakness of the f6 square, also g7. The queen can come in here as well. The king is actually under a lot of attack, but Tate doesn't go for this. He instead plays rook h to e1, which does very temporarily give back the advantage, but after Chibukhchian takes this pawn, likely scared of the move f6 from Tate, Tate just takes the pawn with the knight. Now, the knight being positioned on f5, I'm sure a lot of you have heard of this, knight f5. It's a very, very good thing for white to have when the black king is castled kingside. Why? Because it controls g7. It also controls h6 and e7, a lot of important squares. However, only one of these is important for the tactic that you are about to see. This tactic is so unobvious, in fact, that his grandmaster opponent missed it entirely, playing rook f to c8 and allowing the dynamite move, pause here if you want to solve it, knight takes g7. If Chibukhchian chooses not to capture this piece, then knight h5 would happen, and without the g-pawn, this king is just at the mercy of the queen, the knight, you know, the bishop here as well. That is not a good idea. If Chibukhchian concludes that he cannot take the knight, then he might as well resign in this position. So, of course, he takes the piece. Then Tate, maintaining the tempo, plays queen f6 check. A ruthless check, forcing the king back onto the back rank, to which he can then play e6. Now, the move e6 threatens the move e7, which actually leads to a variety of forced checkmates. I won't show you all of them, but one of them, for instance, if Chibukhchian does nothing really, just shuffles his rook, then e7, and we see king e8, queen h8 check, the king comes up, the bishop comes in, the king comes up again, and there's checkmate there on the e5 square with the queen. I find this position quite amusing in that all of black's pieces are very, very close to the king, and literally none of them do anything to stop this checkmate. In fact, e6 is such a dominant move that Chibukhchian is forced to play a sad move, bishop to d4. This fully sacrifices the bishop, Tate of course accepts it, and then after f takes e6, Chibukhchian's hoping, praying even that some of these pieces can get across to help the king, or maybe even that the king can run across and hide amongst his pieces. However, unfortunately, it is Tate's move. Tate is the one that has the pieces raring to go and attack this unguarded, frail black king. These pieces cannot get over in time, and we see rook to f1 check. King goes across to g8. Tate doesn't even have to give a check. He just calmly lifts the rook to f3. This provides access for this rook to the g3 and h3 squares, ready to further bully this black king. We see e5 here, trying to cut the queen off this diagonal, but it's no use. Queen to g4, we see queen to g7, and here Tate puts the nail in the coffin with a beautiful sacrifice. If you want to try and find the sacrifice, pause the video here. However, Tate plays bishop. Takes h7. Now, as queen takes bishop is of course an illegal response because the queen is pinned to the king, Chibukhchian's forced to go king takes bishop, and after queen h5 check, the king moves back and Tate smoothly, calmly plays rook to g3, pinning that queen to the king, and here Chibukhchian resigns. The best continuation would probably have been just to take the rook, but I mean, for a man like Tate, this is a very trivial game to win. This king literally has just nothing anywhere close to it. These pieces are not able to really get involved. The rook and the queen are going to bully it. It's not a good look, and so Chibukhchian resigns. Thank you very much for watching this video. I hope you guys enjoyed. If you did, leave a like, subscribe if you're new. The channel is seeing some insane growth at the moment. I can't believe I had my first sponsorship. That's really, really cool. So yeah, do make sure if you are interested, check out Hercules Chess. Use my link so they sponsor me again, please. You know, that would be quite nice. And yeah, thank you very much for watching. I will see you in the next one. Goodbye.